Hey everybody, what's going on? Hellmite here, bringing you another video from Grab the Lantern. Today I literally just finished watching the next batch of Arcane episodes and wanted to give you guys my thoughts and my review on the second act of Arcane. Now, there are a couple of caveats as well on this one. Now, obviously, these few episodes were the sort of middle child. Like, the first arc kind of sort of told its own story, while this one is mostly just set up for the climax that will be coming in the next three episodes. So, in that regard, it was a little disappointing, but on the other hand, I did really like what this episode did and a lot of the things that it did set up. To move on to the caveats here, I still overall think Arcane has done a ton of good stuff, so please take any of my quibbles with a grain of salt, because I'm a lore buff and some of the stuff is like super, super minor in the grand scheme of things that I end up overreacting to and then people think I don't like it. I have really, really enjoyed Arcane. And second, what is and isn't canon shouldn't be considered gospel so long as the general strokes of the story are the same. Now, this is in reference to, especially Riot coming out, you know, people having complaints with Arcane and the things it's done to characters, and Riot coming out and saying Arcane isn't canon. I don't think that's a relevant conversation to have, guys. I really feel like trying to take existing lore and saying this is the only way the story can be told ever is not a good look. I think that it ends up being needlessly restrictive, and especially it restricts the ability for Riot to do things like Arcane and tell interesting stories without, you know, without having to always first consult the story Bible and saying, well, does this conflict at all, right? I don't think that's a relevant thing to ever have in mind, especially given that some degree of creative flexibility is needed with stories like these. To follow the exact events of the written lore leads to a story that can be choppy or unclear, and which isn't really made for a visual medium like a TV show, right? If you tried to take all of the champion biographies and backstories and somehow twist that into a coherent television show, I think you would find that it doesn't flow nearly as well, and it's definitely not set up for a visual medium, which is what TV is. So in that regard, right, like, there was always going to be changes made, so regardless of the canonicity of things happening, like, it doesn't really matter too much. So I wouldn't say that Riot saying that, you know, this isn't canon is a big deal. I think that this is still a fair telling of the story, at least so far. And as long as we end up with a conclusion that leaves the characters in mostly the same state as we know them in the lore, then who cares if the path to there was slightly different than before? Moving on to my actual review here, again, Arcane had this part of Arcane had a ton of really good things that I enjoyed, most notably the Jinx and Vi story. They've had excellent character development over these three episodes. I'm loving Jinx's sort of slow descent into the villain that we all know she becomes, but also the conflict between her, right, where she's torn between Jinx and Powder, and Vi especially showing up in episode 6. I maybe should have prefaced this, guys, but spoilers, this is going to delve really, really into the spoilers, so if you guys haven't seen the newest Arcane episodes, do not watch this video. But Jinx meeting Vi and having the sort of tension between the two and trying to figure out exactly who she is and what she wants to do from here, I think was a really, really good arc. And it's going to be interesting to see how Jinx, right, does she go full bore crazy psychopath, or is there something left of Powder in her, especially when she does meet Vi at a later date? I also love that Vi is starting to trust an enforcer enough to become one herself, because we all know that she does become an enforcer, even if she's a bit of a loose cannon. I would like to think that at the end of Arcane, she signs up as sort of a consultant basis, where when they need someone down in the Undercity to do things for them, they can contact Vi, but she's not technically an enforcer, she doesn't have a badge, that kind of a thing. I think would be a really interesting take on the character that still leaves Vi in a very similar state to what we know she is right now, right? Also, speaking of Vi, Caitlyn and Vi have had great chemistry so far, and I absolutely love the not-so-subtle nods to their romantic involvement. Vi smiling when seeing Caitlyn chat up a woman was a great touch, because it's like, Vi's like, oh, okay, cool, yeah, she totally is still gay, and I still have a shot because she's really pretty, right? Like, that was a really, really great touch. I'm not happy that we probably won't get confirmation that matches the sheer levels of heteronormativity that we got with Jace. For example, there's likely going to be no on-screen kiss between Caitlyn and Vi, but I do like that they're at least throwing us a bone and at least making obvious nods that say, yes, these two characters are not straight and they like each other, right? That's a really cool thing going forward that I like to see. And again, we're not going to get to the level of Jace's boning a woman on screen. That was a little gratuitous, and I really, really dislike that, but we'll talk more about that in a bit here. But I do like at the very least that they are really making it clear, yes, these characters like each other, because they don't always do it sometimes. I know Twisted Fate and Graves, for example, they've really kind of limited their ability to do that kind of a thing for those two, but at least we're getting Caitlyn and Vi. And speaking of Caitlyn, Caitlyn's character development has also been really good. I'm a little bummed they didn't give us her former backstory about why she became a cop, but I do like what they've done to showcase her detective skills and her marksmanship, and more importantly, her compassion and the good heart she has, right? Caitlyn isn't just a cop because she wants the power or privilege of being a cop. She became a cop because she wants something active to do, right? She doesn't want to sit on her hands. She doesn't want to be just a fancy noble, right? She wants to do something to help people. And I think the conversation she had with Grayson was a good way of sort of showing the direction in which Caitlyn was able to start moving. And so I really like what they've done with her character so far. Singe being confirmed is somewhat bad for reasons I'll cover later, but I do like that they don't just hint at his involvement in that like first couple episodes where he eventually gets scorched, right? Like, they did actually confirm his existence and makes the quote-unquote leak about him via the subtitles in the first few episodes slightly less of a leak, because it's just, if you don't know who Singed is, those are like irrelevant, right? It's just the name of the character, okay, sure, and then he died in a fire, of course, right? No, actually. And there is some kind of fun discussion to be had about Singed and sort of his involvement with the production of Shimmer. But Shimmer, by the way, is an old lore reference. There was a drug previously mentioned in the Journal of Justice, as a matter of fact, called Shimmer. Now, obviously, the effects were very different, but I do like that not only is Shimmer back in canon, but Singed had a hand in its development, as we can obviously tell by the flowers that he was gathering to being fed to his giant axolotl or salamander, whatever you want to call it, right? Like, that's kind of an interesting arc there for Singed in particular, and I like his involvement, a sort of, he's never the biggest player, but he's always there behind the scenes doing things that are really, really bad. And I like this for Singed because that's always been where he's at in the lore. And so to see him continuing to step into these shoes is really, really nice. I also like the evolution of Piltover and Zahn from their former state into the more recognizable versions, the very steampunky and chempunky, can we use that? But chempunky, right, environments that we know from the from a lot of the other lore and a lot of the other stories that we've had. I still dislike how it's not clear that the cities are vertical. They still really have this sort of east side, west side. You have to cross these bridges in order to get to the other side. Like, I still dislike that, but I like that they at least showed us an evolution from pre-hex tech to post-hex tech. I think that the story jump has, or the time skip has not been entirely explained. It's unclear how long it's been from the events of Act 1 to the events of Episode 4. That's not entirely clear at all, but I do like that they made it clear that there was time elapsed, and I feel like enough time has elapsed, right, to the point where hex tech can be an acknowledged thing that exists in the city. Other than the fact that apparently Hextech isn't in the hands of the people yet, like that was the big reveal that Jace and Victor were going to have, and then they didn't. So it still sort of flies in the face of what we know about Piltover and Zahn, but also it kind of makes sense given that we have the backstory about how Hex Crystals are obtained or produced, for example. And that's one of the things that I think is sort of neither here nor there. On one hand, I get that the writers didn't want to have to evolve Camille and her family into the story, especially since if they did that, they would want to work in her sordid love affair with Hakim, and then Skarner's arc, and then Seraphine's origins, right? Like, and that would involve a whole host of other characters that are sort of tangentially related to the story that they wanted to tell. So on one hand, I do get that, but it does feel a little disrespectful to basically ignore the source of Hex Crystals. And that's one of the big, I think, interesting bits about the creation of Hextech as a whole and in its development. I feel like they're sort of glossed over that in its entirety. We never know where Hex Crystals are from, so maybe in an Arcane Season 2, right, they would actually delve into that a little bit more, but it would be a lot of going back in time and showing us the original discovery, and there's a lot of sort of shenanigans that they'd have to get up to. So I do get why they wouldn't do it, but that's sort of neither here nor there for me. I also kind of like that Silco is a bad guy, but a good dad. That's kind of fun to watch. Like, he's supportive of Jinx. He really does actually, I would suffice to say, love her. But also, he is exploiting her for his own gain. So in that regard, he's sort of set up as this very interesting villain, especially when you compare his style, and especially his relationship to Marcus, the cop, with Vander's style and Grayson, right? Those two working together very much so was a partnership. Grayson realizing, hey, Vander, you're a good guy. I don't want to do anything that would compromise you, right? But also, I do need your assistance with this matter, versus Silco and Marcus, where Silco is very clearly the one in charge, but there's only so much Marcus can do for him, right? Especially when Silco's constantly pushing the envelope, which has been really interesting to show up. My speculation right now, the leader of the Firelight Gang is Echo. But I'm not sure how I feel about that, especially since Echo is, in the game at least, much younger than the Firelight Leader seems to be. This also implies that the Hex Crystal they stole from Jinx in Episode 6 is what he uses to make the Z-Drive, which isn't quite what I wanted, but this is all speculation, so who actually knows? So far, there's no word on the Vander is Warwick theory as of yet, but it's theoretically possible if he shows up in the last few episodes, the technology that the, I can't remember her name, the woman grunt with the Hextech arm, the technology there is strikingly similar to the device Warwick is strapped with, so there's a potential there that that's actually a plot point going forward, so we'll have to see how it goes. But I do want to talk about some things that I feel like are not great in this part. And I think Victor's characterization has not been all there. I did talk about this in my part one. I was interested to see where they took Victor, and I really feel like they just did him dirty in this part. He lost a ton of agency in this telling of the story to the point where he's not even going to become the Machine Herald on his own. He's getting help from Singe, which is like, you know, in his former story, Victor was a genius of his own, and it was his lack of morals and his conflict with Jace that would eventually lead him to the solution of the Glorious Evolution. Everything Victor does in his backstory is things that Victor decided to do. He took the steps forward. He made the realization of emotions are obsolete, and I'm going to replace them with metallic augments, right? In this story, though, Victor is being pushed from situation to situation by factors that are outside of his own control. First, it's his illness, then it's pressure from Heimerdinger, and then it's eventually Singed who's going to help him become the Machine Herald, which is extremely disappointing because it leaves Victor feeling like he's not responsible for anything he's done, right? Even his Hextech dream was mostly achieved with Jace's help. And the worst part about this is they could have kept Victor's agency by using the conflict between Jace and Victor about Hextech lining the pockets of the council versus being used to help people as a way to get him to become disillusioned with emotional decisions and then use the illness that he does have as a way to get him to go down the path of the Machine Herald, right? Like, that would have been a really interesting thing. We still could have had the schism between Jace and Victor. Victor still would have been in charge of his own destiny, but instead they opted for a worse telling of the story in which Victor has no say in his own destiny and is going to end up becoming the champion we know, basically because the story said you have to, as opposed to being a decision that he opted into. The creation of the Hex Core, I think, was still a really cool nod, and I liked that, especially given that the Hex Core is all about evolution and change, and that was the whole shtick with it in the plot, right, is that it's magic that's able to evolve and learn on its own. The comparison between it and a world rune, I think, was a little too far for me. I really don't feel like Victor would walk around with a veritable world rune on his staff, but maybe that's something that Riot wants to be going on with. I don't know how I feel about it, but in general, I'm super disappointed with how they did Victor. And Jace isn't safe from bad characterization either. Instead of characterizing him as the brilliant and talented, but mostly arrogant and bullheaded man that he is in the League of Legends lore, Jace is the golden child. He never makes mistakes. Everything Jace does is perfect, and he's the greatest man who's ever lived. And now, to be fair, we may see the consequences of some of his actions in the next part, but he really hasn't felt like he's an actual character. It just feels like Jace has always made the correct decision in every way, shape, and form. I also dislike him being on the council, and I'm really hoping he gets kicked off at some point, because I liked Jace as a brilliant inventor who styled himself as the Defender of Tomorrow, again, getting to that sort of arrogance that he's like, I fight for a brighter tomorrow, regardless of what anyone else wants to say about it, rather than basically being given the title by the city itself, who was saying, hey, you're in charge of everything going forward. And speaking of which, the Hex Gates are a pretty big plot hole that I don't have a lot of time to hop into. I don't want to say a plot hole, but the whole point of Piltover in the written lore is that it is an important trade route because it's on an isthmus. Anyone who wants to go from east to west Valoran, or vice versa, has to go through Piltover and Zaun, and that's how they make a lot of their money. The Hex Gates sort of ruin this, especially given that, like, do they build Hex Gates everywhere? Why isn't Noxus using this as an invasion route? Would Demacia really let you do this? Would the Freljord not, like, vandalize it while you're gone? I dislike the Hex Gates as a concept. I know it was a good flashy way for them to show the power of Hextech, but I'm really disappointed with their decision to add that as a world element, as that's the, like, hardest to justify story decision they've made. Everything else, even the bad Victor characterization, I can almost forgive, but that I can't. And finally, the whole Medarda thing is just weird. The character is basically not a character. Like, the only reason she exists is to push Jace into the role the writers want him to be in, and also as an extremely boring love interest. Like, we know nothing about this character. She just sits around doing nothing, looking glamorous. She has no agency of her own. The only reason she exists is to basically do things to make Jace do things. Like, she's not a character. I'm sorry. And there's no reason for her to be here. And that, I think, is why I have the biggest problem with the love interest angle. I am very happy that they put the nail in the coffin of Caitlyn and Jace, which they were kind of sort of hinting at. But Lady Medarda, I just don't think has a purpose in the story. I'm going to be completely honest with you guys. I think she's irrelevant and does not deserve to be in the story, quite frankly. They could have found a better vessel for, and maybe her absence would have led to a better story for both Jace and Victor, but that's neither here nor there. Anyways, this has gone on long enough, so thank you guys for bearing with me as I go through this sort of rant. Again, I just watched the episode, so a lot of this is sort of hot and fresh, as opposed to having some time to simmer and cool down a little bit. But let me know what you thought of the most recent part of Arcane down in the comment section below. I love hearing your guys' thoughts, especially what you guys thought about the last part, so if you guys have any other comments, let me know down in the comments. If you enjoyed the video today, go ahead and leave it a like. And if you really enjoyed the video, consider subscribing. I upload a video every Monday, Friday, and on patch days as well. Once again, thank you guys so very much for watching. I do appreciate it. And I'll talk to you all later.